Now, Ontario, I'd say, was confused. I would say that there are strains of good. There's an attempt on the part of some and some legislation to do some good things here. And of course, there's our Clean Energy, the Clean Water Act, which empowers local communities to take action to prevent harm to their local water sources and requires public participation at every step of the way in any new project that impacts water. So we do have the beginnings of some good work here. On the other hand, we have the Open for Business Act, which McGinty brought in several years ago, which basically sees water as a resource to be used to lure water-intensive business to Ontario. You see it all around the Great Lakes. I mean, some really blatant advertising in some American cities about, you know, have the workers come up from the south and the southwest and come here and we'll give you preferential access to our water and preferential water rates. So the message is really mixed here in Ontario. Basically, we get the McGinty government using our water to promote access to companies like the bottled water industry. They are on their website quite positive about the bottled water industry. Massive development of rural communities. I really worry about Simcoe County and what's going to happen here. This beautiful, not just the quarry, but I think that if you look at what the plans are, you start to see a stakes and ladders board game with the sources, the water sources being used to come into all these industries and communities. And this myth of abundance, I think, is very real here when it comes to giving the green light to projects like the quarry that we're here to talk about tonight. And the notion, I mean, if you hadn't put up a fight here, the quarry would be underway now. I mean, the government is not stopping and asking the questions first. They're assuming that development is good and asking the questions only when we scream bloody murder. You guys, probably most of you know the statistics or the facts around this. For those who don't, I'll just very briefly remind us that this is a over 2,300 acre open pit limestone quarry to be proposed. It would border the Niagara Escarpment, which is a UNESCO biosphere reserve. It would destroy productive farmland. It would pollute the air with 40 ton trucks traveling local roads 24/7. It would be devastating to the land, the species, the community that lives here. And it would threaten the water. Below the proposed quarry lies the Amabel Lockhart Guelph Aquifer, which forms the headwaters of five major river systems, the Pine, the Grand, the Nottawasaga, the Saugeen, and the Beaver, and is the drinking water source for over a million people. They are talking about blasting 60 meters deeper than Niagara Falls beneath the water table and extracting 600 million liters of water a day. Highland plans to pump that water, collected daily on the open pit mine floor, and then of course contaminated with the heavy metals, the blasting residue, the diesel fuels and so on, and dump it back into wells in the area around the site, which of course will contaminate the watershed. I want to add to this the threat of NAFTA. We've got some very recent disturbing challenges. NAFTA gives corporations certain fundamental rights that never existed before. However, since NAFTA, almost every bilateral investment and trade agreement in the world does have a clause that allows corporations to bypass their own government and sue the government of another country. This quarry is backed by Baupost, which is a Boston-based multi-million-dollar hedge fund, and as such would have rights to sue the Canadian government if any time after the contract has been signed, any level of government changes its mind or sets new environmental restrictions. And we even think that they might have a case to say that they've already put so much money into the project now and could at least threaten a challenge. We have several examples that we should be noting. One was a quartz quarry in Digby, Nova Scotia, where I spent my early years. My dad was the first town social worker in Digby, Nova Scotia. And this U.S. company is suing for more than $100 million in damages. They're suing the Canadian government. It has to be the Canadian government because it's the Canadian government that signed the agreement, signed NAFTA. After it was denied an expansion to expand, so they just considered it their right to continue to expand. St. Mary's Cement near Hamilton is owned by an American arm of a Brazilian company, and they are seeking $275 million in damages because of the halting of that quarry. So they can claim damages, but you should also know that more recently, a corporation from another NAFTA country can claim to own the actual water or can claim for damages to that water. And the example I give you is a company called Abitibi Bow Water, which is an American pulp and paper company that was operating for years in Newfoundland. 4 years ago, left Newfoundland on their own. Nobody kicked them out. They left jobs and pensions and communities really struggling behind. And then they turned around and they said to this province of Newfoundland, you owe us money for the water and timber rights we left behind. And Danny Williams was the premier then, and he basically told them where they could put that on the mission. So they turned to their good friend Stephen Harper, and they launched a NAFTA challenge, Chapter 11 challenge. Stephen Harper didn't wait to go to a NAFTA challenge. He didn't stand up for Newfoundland and say, well, at least I'll fight for you. He turned around and basically said, you're right, and gave them $130 million.
Oh my.
Now, the money itself is bad, but what is really serious is the precedent it set, because it said now that these corporations under these trade agreements have protections and they can claim to own the water that they need for their operations. Think about the American energy companies operating in the tar sands and the billions and billions of dollars they could sue if, dream along, a future Alberta government ever said, you've got to cut your water use in half, you're destroying our water. Or uranium mining, American uranium mining companies, American agribusiness companies operating here, and vice versa. Canadian mining companies, which are the worst in the world by a long shot, we're now using trade agreements. There's one in El Salvador where a Canadian mining company is suing the government of El Salvador because they actually stopped the expansion of a terrible mine there. So this is a tool that's being used by corporations, backed by governments, certainly in our case backed by the Canadian government, to stop local communities, municipalities, states, and provinces from protecting their resources, protecting their environment, and protecting their people. And it's corporations now to challenge any level of government, municipal, schools, hospitals, whatever, that are in any way say we're going to protect local jobs, local economies, local food production, local farmers, can't do any of that anymore. It's a very dangerous agreement, and would also give the two biggest water utilities in the world, Suez and Veolia, which are from France, the right to come in and start challenging to have municipal contracts open up so that they can run our water systems on a private basis. So these agreements from other countries, these trade agreements, are putting our water in danger. And this is a very real and specific threat to the quarry here, because Baupost is an American hedge fund and could quite conceivably do what several others have done and challenge the decision or challenge to be compensated for it. I think it's also very important for us to know that we are seeing right now, there was a big mining conference in Toronto last week, and Stephen Harper got up and made, not Stephen Harper, his minister, got up and made an announcement that they're going to start streamlining. Watch words like streamlining. What it means is deregulation. They are going to harmonize provincial and federal laws and standards of regulations on new energy and mining operations in Canada. And they've already announced that they're going to dramatically reduce the power of the federal environmental assessment process. And there we have this hearing just beginning on the Gateway pipeline to take the bitumen from the tar sands to the coast of British Columbia, punch a hole through the Rockies, as one of the companies said, and ship it by tanker to Asia. We've got thousands of people lined up to speak at this environmental assessment hearing. And when Harper goes last month to China, who does he bring but the head of Enbridge, the company itself, and 39 other corporate CEOs, and says basically, what he's saying is to the Chinese government, you will get this oil. You know, this little thing that we're doing called environmental assessment, just don't be silly. Here's the real deal. The real deal is I brought the head of the pipeline that's going to build it. I brought him here, and he's going to, you know, we're together going to make sure this happens. I mean, it's what happens when this kind of thing happens. I believe with all my heart that democracy has been compromised so badly that I don't know what quite that I call it anymore, but it worries me very, very much. So when we're seeking here, federal government stepping in, or there's been, you know, this desire to see the federal government step into the quarry situation here because of the great public outcry, again, the resistance is just incredible. Anything they don't have to deal with, they won't. Anything they do have to deal with, they won't. So they're certainly not going to start with anything that they can get out of. And I think it's also important for us to know that there's a free-for-all coming. I feel it. It wasn't said as a compliment, but once somebody who worked with me said, your greatest skill is you're like a truffle hound for future problems. I said, well, what a lovely image. He said, no, you know ahead of time what's coming. And I have to tell you, what's coming is an assault on every tree in our country, and every fish in the waters in and surrounding our country, on every mineral, on every freshwater source, on all the energy, on all the natural gas through fracking. We are going to see an all-out assault. Europe is locked in a really tight competition with China to lock down access to raw resources because they've run out of them. And so they want to come to countries like Canada, and they want to get access to these minerals and energy and trees and forests and all of the fresh water and so on. And they want to lock it in with these trade agreements and these investor state rules that allow them to sue. You know, if they don't, they call it their right to profit. I love that term. If their right to profit is compromised by foolish things like health and safety, environmental protections. So the struggle we're having around the quarry here is happening all over the country. I was just in on Vancouver Island, where they're fighting the Raven coal mine in the Comox Valley. There are six other coal mines, open pit coal mines, planned for beautiful Vancouver Island. I mean, can you believe this? It's like, you know, it's just like, you know, some powers have decided this is going to be, and it does not matter what the people want. And I think what we're going to see is more and more people standing up and saying no, standing their ground, you know, like out of the Lord of the Rings with Gandalf, you shall not pass. I do think there's going to be you shall not pass. And people are going to stand up and put their lives on the line. I did it a wee bit when I got arrested in Ottawa on September 26th, when we had a protest against the Keystone Pipeline. It was quite funny because I had been in Washington when Bill McGibbon and 350.org and that folks were holding those daily, beautiful daily gatherings. They were gatherings outside the White House, and then at a certain time every day, a bunch of people would go over and stand in front of the White House, which you're allowed to do, but you're not allowed to loiter. So they would loiter a bit, and the police would come along. It's like a morality play. Everybody knew their exact rule, right? The police would come, and they'd say three times, you have to leave, you have to leave. They'd be putting the barriers up. People would be singing songs, and then they would one by one get arrested. So Bill McGibbon said, you know, are you going to get arrested? And my husband Andrew was with me, and he's a lawyer, and he was like, she's not getting arrested. And he would have my, I'm getting arrested. No, you're not. Because he was worried that I wouldn't be able to get back into the U.S., which is a real worry. So then came the September 26th event that we held here with several other groups, and we negotiated with the police that anybody who stepped over a barrier would get arrested. So I was thinking about it. My only worry is about limits to travel, because I travel a lot. But going back and forth, and I happened to receive a lovely award from the Sierra Club in the U.S. 2 days before in San Francisco at an event where, at the Sierra Club, where Bill McGibbon was giving a speech. And during his speech, he turned to me and he said, "No, everybody, Maude's getting arrested on Monday." And I thought, well, that's that decision done. So I neglected to tell my husband. It was really funny. Monday morning we got up and I said, "You know, it's going to be just nothing today. You should just stay at the office. Nothing, don't want you coming." So it was a wonderful day. It was very hot. Very hot, a really hot Ottawa day. And we had lots of drummers and First Nations music and speakers. And those of us getting arrested put a little green armband around ourselves. So at one point I was sitting off on the grass waiting for, you know, speeches and stuff. And up comes Andrew, the only person there in a suit. It's like, "Can't you go away? You look like a lawyer." He said, What's that green armband?" I said, "What green armband?" Anyway, it was a wonderful day, and we were treated very nicely. My officer was a great tall man of RCMP guy who knew who I was and did not want to arrest me. So I stepped over the barrier, and he said, "Please, would you go back?" I said, "I'm so sorry." He said, you really have to ask you." I said, "I never do things like this, but I really can't go back over that barrier." And so we're smiling at each other, and I've seen pictures of it. So we're bobbing. I'm saying, "I'm so sorry." He's saying, "I'm so sorry." And he says to me, "You know, I'm going to have to arrest you and put handcuffs on you." I said, "I know. I'm really sorry to make you do this." So he handcuffs me, and then he says, "Is that too tight?" And I said, "I think it's supposed to hurt a little bit." It was just a little joy. Then I got escorted off of the premises, not to be allowed back for a year. And I said, "You mean I can't go back to the protest?" And